Okay. Hello, Buddhist Geeks. Vincent Horn here again for another interview slash conversation slash exploration. And today I am joined again by our friend Ken McLeod. Ken, it's awesome to be speaking with you again.
As usual. My pleasure. I enjoy our conversations very much, and I look forward to this one.
Yeah, and last time we talked, we kind of had more of just a kind of free-form conversation style interview, and it seemed like both of us enjoyed that. So we're going to do something similar today, which is a lot like conversations we were having when I lived in Los Angeles, and we would go hiking, and we just sort of just talk about all this stuff. And I found those conversations really, really interesting. So it seems fitting to just kind of transplant that over into the kind of Buddhist Geek space and just see what happens.
Well, it's fine with me. In fact, my preference, because I just don't feel like I'm an expert at anything, so I'm not interested in being interviewed.
Okay, well, maybe we'll talk about that. Because I'll want to know what you mean by that. Cool. So, and just a sense of what we wanted to explore today, I've been thinking a lot about truth and running up against the impulse to find the truth, both interiorly and then also with people I've been working with, kind of in a meditation teacher role. And it just seems like something that is really common. In fact, I'm sort of remembering when I first got into meditation, I framed the whole goal as finding the truth. That was how I framed the entire thing that I was up to. And it wasn't just intellectual, it also felt really, really visceral, like I need to find the truth, figure out what's really happening here.
Okay, do you want to look at this from a philosophical, sociological, psychological, or epistemological perspective? Or should we just start? Because I think they're all relevant.
Okay, well let's start wherever you think would be most interesting.
Well, that's very hard for me to assess, but let's... The first thing I'm going to say is that I resonate very much with what you're saying. Certainly at certain phases of my own practice history, I was very concerned with the truth, quotation marks. And that's gone through a lot of different changes over the years. As I've come to appreciate, and this may sound very surprising to people who listen to this, it's a bit of a red herring. The reason I was very happy to read when you suggested this topic is that I had an experience, I guess it's 5 years ago now, which is very directly related to this topic. I was reading a book, and the book is a book called Straw Dogs by a philosopher slash economist at the London School of Economics. And it is a very powerful attack on liberal humanism, or critique. And as I discussed with Stephen Batchelor, he said, yeah, it's hard to refute his arguments, which makes it very interesting. And during a break between two retreats that I was teaching, I was reading this book for the third time because I found some of the ideas in it so fascinating. And I read this line, philosophers, I may be paraphrasing it, this may not be perfect quotation, philosophers claim that they are seeking truth when, in fact, they are seeking peace. And when I read this line, everything fell out of my mind. And I had 18 people due to arrive at a retreat in a couple of days. I just finished teaching another retreat. And I read those two lines, and the very last thing I wanted to do was to teach that retreat. But I had to. And for the next 6 to 8 months or so, I didn't know what was up and what was down, what was back and what was forward, what was left and what was right. My mind was so open and so clear, and everything changed in my body. So much changed. And one of the things that I realized is that I had been practicing for a very long time, probably since the very beginning of my practice, with the assumption that if I could find the truth, then all my problems would be solved. Mm-hmm. And I think you're relating to that by how you opened this up. And I realized it was completely not true.
It's a funny way of putting it.
Yeah. And it was so completely not true that, and that was shattering. I was like, oh, the very basis of my motivation for practice has been a false assumption. Mm. I'm like, wow. And my relationship with teaching changed. How I taught changed. How I felt physically. It was a very, very profound shift. And so it put me in mind of something that I think is so, and this is the cultural or sociological aspect, that's why I threw that one in, that the, I think it's, I can't remember, it's John 8:32 or John 16:32, it's one of the two. But it's know ye the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Mm-hmm. I think Christ says this, and this permeates our culture very, very deeply. It's also the basis of Marxism, actually, and this whole idea that if we can know the truth, then everything will be taken care of, and it's very deep in our culture because we find the same thing in The Secret, and the way that that's played out. In, we need to talk about this, Vince. and you take such pop cultural things as like Indiana Jones or whatever. There's always this notion that there is this truth, and the X-Files, of course, that there's this truth out there, we find it also, and in a certain sense, it's a kind of a distortion or a reinterpretation or something of the scientific notion, is that you're looking for the truth. Now, that isn't how I regard science myself or mathematics or whatever, but it is how they are popularly regarded without question.
Sure.
The gospel is presented as the truth, and I'm here in Alabama now, so I've got that all around me. I think there's a very strong sociological thing. I've touched a bit on the epistemological. The psychological is that it's been my experience, and I can see this in myself, and I'll leave you to decide this, whether this relates to you, but when you grow up in a chaotic environment, then one of the characteristics of people who grow up in a chaotic environment is they think if they can just figure out what's going on, then they'll be able to manage it. So they're looking for the truth. There's a psychological disposition developed from that early experience of finding the truth, because it's a way of coping in that moment. So that's a psychological take on it. So
yes.
I think it's a very rich topic. I think it's something people look for, and there's the other thing that I find is that people want to be able to rely on the truth, because if they can rely on the if there is such thing as the truth about a situation, then it ends all arguments, supposedly.
Because there's, now there's no more doubt. Yeah, there's no more doubt. There's no more confusion. Settled.
It's settled, and in a certain sense, our legal system is supposed to be based on that, but it doesn't work that way in practice, and it particularly doesn't work that way in the modern era. And this is what a philosopher politician in Italy, Bettami, I think, or something like that, says. And he does a very deep exploration of what truth is in the modern age, because it isn't a set of facts anymore, because the facts are open to different sorts of interpretations, quite different interpretations. And so I think one of the things that we're being faced with in today's age, and this is something you and I have discussed a bit, is that in the postmodern world, there isn't an absolute truth. There isn't even an agreed-upon truth. There are all of these different truths.
Yes.
And so truth is dependent on context. And this is a very, very different world from the world in which I grew up in.
Absolutely, yeah. I hear, you know, phrases from different philosophers like truth claims that are contextually situated. Crazy phrases like that.
Well, I mean, but it says it all. I would there's a shorter one which I came across recently where fiction fails facts because in the modern world facts are merely successful fictions.
Hmm. Interesting. There was the first line of a poem that you read at the first Buddhist Geeks conference. I've been going back.
Oh, yes.
And yeah, I know you remember it.
Only tortured people seek truth. Only tortured men. Yeah. Only tortured people seek truth. Yeah.
I wondered if you could talk a little bit about that, because in some ways it's that torment or that torture of seeking truth that maybe is in some ways the only way we can notice the kind of problematic relationship with that idea of kind of finding the truth.
That's okay. I mean, I'm going to answer your question a little differently. But what you asked here opens up a very interesting line that I hadn't thought of before. And I'm going to generalize it a little bit and then make it specific, if that's okay with you.
Totally fine, Ken.
The general thing is, and this is a practice point, whenever you find yourself really concerned, latching onto something, get suspicious or be suspicious. That's the general thing. So let's suppose, for the sake of our conversation here, that you and I are really concerned with truth. Mm-hmm. Now, if we apply what I've just said, let's be a little suspicious about that. Why am I concerned with truth so much? Why is it so important to me? Now, that sounds like, you know, completely, well, everybody's concerned with truth, but that actually isn't true in and of itself. This links very quickly back to some of the thoughts that I was expressing before. You know, it's a coping mechanism. It's really important to me because it's how I navigate the world, et cetera, et cetera. If I ask myself, why am I so concerned with truth, I can actually feel the emotional drive there, the emotional investment in that.
Yeah.
Well, okay, like, that's a good, you know, and it has such a hard and hard may be the wrong word, but it's a very visceral thing. So there's a very significant investment, and it's easy for me to imagine how that can distort how I would look at things, because I'm so emotionally invested in this insistence on truth.
Yes. Okay. That's interesting.
Go ahead.
I wanted to tie something in personally, because I feel like tracking this in terms of personal experience, like you started out with in the beginning, the story of kind of reading this line and then suddenly things dropping away for a moment.
For 6 or 8 months. That's a long moment. So, it's still with me, actually.
I wonder if in some ways, like for me, I think the term enlightenment could easily be a stand-in for the term truth. Like, I'm seeking the truth, or I'm seeking enlightenment. And I, of course, you know, have all these particular ideas about what that means. You know, I have these sort of models that I've inherited. In my own practice, it was a specific, you know, Mahasi Sayadaw style, noting meditation, progressive insight leading to the first stage of enlightenment. And then if you're lucky, you know, some other stages will come. But very, very much a singular, clear pathway. And as you move, you know, down this gradual spectrum, you get closer and closer to the truth of things. And what happens, though, when that whole model... So this is my question. On the one hand, within that context, some of those things are, in my experience, accurate descriptions of the phenomenology of experience, accurate descriptions of some things that shift or change, and that's amazing. But then on the other hand, as soon as I leave that context, or as soon as I look at it from another angle, like as soon as I even look at it from another Buddhist perspective, suddenly the whole question of what that enlightenment is and what it means gets challenged directly. And so for me, that's part of why this question became so interesting in the last few years, because it was clear to me that whatever truth I thought I'd realized was, you know, clearly not being described in other systems and other people, and it was easy to challenge it. And there are flaws and holes in the system, and it's like, oh shit! If there's holes in the system, maybe the ship is sinking.
Could you give me an example of one or two of the challenges that you found were?
Yeah, what one challenge was the sort of constant self-evaluation, that habit that I developed as part of my practice, and the way that I was always constantly trying to figure out, okay, how am I doing now, and how does it line up with this external sort of evaluation criteria that I have, or that I've inherited, or both. And that was... increasingly became a challenge, at one, because it was painful to be constantly trying to evaluate where I was, and two, I found that I no longer could. I found that I didn't know what I was experiencing and how it related to the models. It didn't seem to match up anymore.
Okay, thank you. The word enlightenment is... I think it's been a very problematic word. It was one of the earlier translations and stuck with us, and as so often happens with early translations, it probably wasn't the ideal word, and it has created all kinds of problems which we're still dealing with. I almost always, the word in Sanskrit, of course, is bodhi. Which I prefer to translate as awakening. But if you look at the, and I'm more familiar with the Tibetan than with the Sanskrit, but the Tibetan is composed of two words, jong and chup. And jong refers to a clearing away process. A clearing away of confusion and distortion, or if you want to put it in more Western terms, a projection, beliefs and projections, if there. And chup refers to the growth and the flowering of qualities and abilities.
Interesting.
So when you hear that, you don't hear anything about truth. You're clearing away distortions and things that prevent you from seeing things, experiencing things clearly, and you're developing capacities and abilities, and that is the process of awakening. In fact, I'm working on a piece of writing right now in which I define awakening as the or the work that I do with Unfettered Mind as helping people find a path which progressively clears away beliefs and projections and develops abilities and attention and awareness. That's it. And how far one goes on that path, I'm not sure that there is any end to it. I'm not sure that there is any end result. I mean, you know, you just get better and better and better. And we see this in every other area of human endeavor. You know, you get basketball players and, you know, you get Michael Jordan, and then you get Shaquille O'Neal, and then you get, who's the big Chicago one?
I know who you're thinking of, but I can't.
And now you've got LeBron James.
All the basketball fans, LeBron, yeah. Basketball fans and Buddhist geeks are cringing.
So am I. I mean, this is Michael Jordan. There we are. You know, and who is the, you know, each one of these, they're building incredible abilities. Is any one of them the enlightened or an enlightened basketball player? Well, it's kind of an absurd question when you put it that way. And I think it would be helpful to look at spiritual practice in the same way, is that one develops abilities and there is talent under all these things. And you watch some of these people play, and it's extraordinary. And you can learn, and they can inspire you to play basketball yourself, to play basketball better. I'm saying tennis, but I think it's exactly the same thing in the spiritual arena. So I'm not sure that it makes sense really to talk about a state of enlightenment as more a process of awakening.
Okay.
And does that help?
It brings up some more questions. It does.
Cool.
It is interesting. I mean, it's very helpful. But I had a couple questions come up as you're describing it that way. So with the Tibetan kind of words and breaking that down, you know, clearing away, and then the cultivation or development of certain kinds of capacities. The question I have though is, isn't it also the case that every tradition, even if they have that idea, that they also have pretty specific and sometimes fixed ideas about what gets cleared away and how, and then also what developed and how, and which one of those things are most important? And isn't that itself kind of a model? We start constructing this kind of model for what the idealized kind of person is, or the idealized spiritual practitioner or whatever.
I think you're absolutely right about that. I think that each culture develops their own ideas about what spiritual attainment or spiritual awakening looks like. And thus emphasizes different aspects of practice. And I would go further that, because I agree with you very completely on this, and it's something I've given more than a little thought to. The traditions that are handed down and that we receive are the ones that a certain set of people found worked for them and their own spiritual aspirations. And so there's kind of a reinforcement that over time the system selects people who for whom it works, and they're the ones who continue it.
Interesting.
Okay. Now, the reason I had to face this myself is that in the early 90s, it was very clear to me, because of challenges I was facing in my own practice, that all of the traditional doors were closed. I'd learned these practices, I'd been trained in them very deeply, I knew how they worked, I knew that they did work, and I knew how they worked, and I could explain that and guide others very effectively. However, whenever I've tried to practice them myself, I just got sick really quickly. There's large energy imbalances, all kinds of problems that I was facing. And so I can remember very clearly sitting outside my office building in my car, asking myself the question, what happened to the people in previous generations for whom the system didn't work? And then I realized, when I asked that question, each of them had to find their own path. And I imagine many of them did. But that their path did not get transmitted because it wasn't part of the orthodox system. And so each generation, people for whom the system didn't work, had to find their own path. And that's when I had the inspiration for what I wanted to do with Unfettered Mind, which was to create a place, quotation marks, that's a metaphor, not a physical place, for people whose path took them outside the traditional institutions and frameworks. And basically that's what I've done is to concentrate on those kinds of people, which has worked very nicely.
Okay. So just bringing another dimension to this whole thing, I found that the looking for truth, it also comes with it a kind of looking for authority, looking for something or someone
that's right,
who's telling me how things are. And so the approach then is to go, okay, this is how things are, and I've got to have faith in that. You know, ends up becoming a factor, even if we're sort of validating, even if we're sort of testing as verified, there's still a quality of kind of, okay, I believe that this is true. I believe that you know kind of better than I do what's going on here. And then I'm going to try to kind of conform in some ways my experience to that so I can live up to it. So what's up with authority? You know, this is such a big question.
Well, and not just in the spiritual realm.
Sure.
We have exactly the same relationship with science. And people give up the authority of their own experience to doctors and psychologists and things like that all the time. This is going to make you feel better. Well, it doesn't. Well, just keep taking more of it and it will. And they give it up and sometimes the medication doesn't work. We've come to doubt our own experience in many, many ways. And I think you're absolutely, I think it's a very important point that you're bringing up here. Let me throw this back at you. What leads you to take something as an authority?
I mean, I guess there's several things, but one is, do other people consider this person an authority? You know, that's definitely one thing I've considered. The other thing is there something inspirational about this person? Do they seem to get something that I'm also interested in somehow? That's, I'd say, another way that I've sort of tried to assess that in the past.
I think those are two very important considerations. Another consideration, I think, is does this make sense to me? Does what he's saying make sense to me? This is how we connect with a teacher in the spiritual realm, but also in other realms, in academia and in the arts as well. this person embodies something that I want to know.
Yes.
Or I want to be. And other people think well of him or her. And so we trust that. But now something very subtle happens, which we often don't notice. And that is, in our enthusiasm, it's very easy to cede our own agency.
Yes.
And we may not realize that we have. And now it moves from the domain of choice to the domain of belief. And if that has happened in a way that we aren't aware of it, then we feel that we have to do this and we don't know why.
Okay, interesting. This is sort of making me think of a few different distinctions here. One is like, okay, one is I hear someone describing the truth, you know, the truth about whatever, enlightenment, in this case, or awakening. And I go, okay, and then they tell me, okay, this is how you get there. And I have really no way of knowing, so I just take that on faith and I go for it, and I do what they say, and I completely let my agency over to this person or to this group of people. But then there's a distinction between that and I would call it almost like a more rational, secular approach to this, which is, hey, this is what I've learned. You can put these things to test. You can experiment, and you can see what they lead to. It's a way of like kind of nibbling on a little bit of what they're saying, and getting kind of like a sense for that it's accurate. And there's more of a sense of validating it yourself. You know, trying to put the authority back to the person and saying, "Hey, run this experiment. If you get the same results, then you're on the right path." Now that seems different, but it seems like what we're kind of exploring is something in some ways altogether different from both of those, which is questioning the very framework to begin with that's offered or that we're seeking out. It's questioning even the motivation that drove us to get to the point where we said, okay, this is something I'm interested in and I want to go into it.
Well, all three operate in all of us, I think.
Sure.
And I think that in earlier times, in traditional societies, certainly in the initial stage, you only had the first option. And that's because there was a notion in those cultures that there was a truth or there was a way of doing things that hadn't changed for a very long time. This is what you did. And you just learned it. And that was that.
Yes.
Now, there are very powerful qualities to that way of learning. Is the learning tends to be very, very deep. I mean, it gets right into the body. This is how the old masters taught their students in painting. They would just, you know, wash these brushes and they would say, this is how you do it. And they wouldn't allow them to do it any other way. And they learned how to apply to canvas. They didn't experiment in a lot of stuff. They learned very, very specific ways. And they became very good. However, they were limited in what they could do because they had only learned that one skill, that one way.
Highly limited in a certain way, right?
Highly limited and highly learned, you know, really fantastically.
Yes.
And so as the realm of knowledge broadens, then we want to have more of that experimental method that you described, where there's a testing, and that is character, and there's a testing of how does this work for me, etc. And that is characteristic of a modern approach, where you find learned subjects by your own exploration.
And Ken, isn't it the case though with that approach? The thing I've noticed about it, the tricky part of it, is, it's like, okay, try this experiment, you know, see if it works for you. But then secretly, the subtext is this is still the best way to do it, or this is still excuse my slang, this is still the what we're offering here. This is the shit. There's still that sense.
I think there can be. I think I've been guilty of that myself in the past, but to be honest. But I don't think that is a true expression of the experimental method. I'm thinking, did you see the movie Pia, about Pia Bush, developed dance theater? An amazing movie as far as I'm concerned, especially if you can see it in 3D. It's a bunch of her dance students recounting what it was like to study with her. And as a dance teacher, she was looking for how does this person express themselves in dance? Not to make them express how she expresses herself in dance, but what was the true expression for that person? And she's phenomenal. I was just so awestruck by what she was able to do, as her students recounted it. And I found it deeply moving and inspiring movie. And that kind of consideration certainly influenced me, you know, not just from Pia Bush, but from other things. I came to see teaching as, and I certainly did this in my teacher's development program, is finding trying to get people to practice the way that I practiced or teach the way that I taught, but what was true for them. What was congruent? What was the fullest expression? And this goes back to our definition of enlightenment. What cleared away the confusion? What the abilities developed that allowed them to engage their life and their practice in the fullest way? And that's so. I think what you say is true. I think there can be a subtext, but that is a kind of false expression of that experimental exploration approach. I think when it's you do get teachers who are totally interested in bringing out whatever the potential is in the student, and they're the really remarkable teachers in my mind. But then you have this. Go ahead.
No, please.
Well, then you have this third category, which is, questioning what am I doing here at all, and. I think that is so important. And the reason I think it's so important is that I find, and this I think is something that people should do on a fairly regular basis. I don't know how regular, maybe yearly, maybe every 2 or 3 years, I don't know, something like that. But I think it's very, very important because time and time again I've run into people whose practice has gone flat. And it's gone flat because they have lost touch with their motivation. And sometimes it's because they've actually got out of their practice what they wanted, and they're done. They may not be enlightened, but they got out of the practice what they were looking for. And other kinds, it's because they've lost touch with their motivation by accepting somebody else's agenda.
Yes.
I.e. they've lost touch with their own agency.
Yes.
Now, one of the challenges in there are many challenges in here. One of the great qualities of the traditional approach is where you do this, and then do this, and then do this, is that you could put people through practices which were very arduous and really demanding of people. And they might not get anything else out of it except that by pushing themselves to do that practice, they developed certain abilities. It's like, you know, they did push-ups for a while, they developed arm muscles, or they were like a musical student. They develop facility in scales and intervals and things like that.
The Mr. Miyagi approach.
Yeah, well, in a certain sense, that's right, yeah. And one of the questions I have about teaching is when you do the exploration model, how do you inspire or get people to put the really, really hard work in to just developing basic abilities? Because it's boring, tedious work. Like, who's that? Oh, I've lost all my sports people. The great shortstop for the Baltimore Orioles. Anyway, he fielded 1,000 balls every day. And you look at these star basketball I heard this account of this rookie NBA player. And after practice was finished, he'd be out on the court. And he'd be shooting shots from one place on the court until he could sink the basket every time. And then he would move 6 inches to the left and shoot from there until he could sink baskets every time. And then he'd move 6 inches from that. And what he was doing was training in his body what each of the shots were every time. And that's what I mean about the hard work. Well, spiritual practice, you have to put in the same kind of hard work of really developing abilities. And I think this is very important because there's so many facets of spiritual work and spiritual insight that are dependent on having certain capacities of attention and awareness, which are developed that way, which you can't possibly understand intellectually. And I see people spending so much energy trying to understand them intellectually, when what they need to do, it's analogous to trying to understand how to lift a car rather than going out how to work weights until you had the capacity to lift a car.
Okay, interesting. I've been sort of playing with this metaphor. I think it sort of connects to what you're saying of being a programmer. As a programmer, you're working to create, basically through instructions and code, this thing that runs and does stuff. And I've been thinking about, with a programmer, as a programmer, you come in and you have all these different libraries of code that you have access to, things people have already done that already do certain functions. And you can, instead of having to recreate everything and build everything, you can borrow from these libraries and you can kind of include them and integrate them into your code. And I've been starting to think of, Buddhist practitioners as Buddhist programmers. Some ways we're all having to kind of code this thing ourselves. And yet we do have this wonderful code base, this library that the traditions offer, that if we could understand what that code does and find ways to kind of weave it into our own kind of creative process, that there's something really great about having that, as opposed to feeling like, okay, I've got to just go off on my own and figure all of this out by myself and be the great, amazing one.
Well, yes. I think what you're saying here is a very good good point. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. There are people who have put in long hours and learned how certain things work. But let's take your programming metaphor and extend it a bit. How many programmers program exactly the same way?
Not that many that I know. I mean, maybe they're similar styles, but I mean, everyone seems to have a little bit of a difference in how they code and how they comment on their code. And I mean, it's probably a whole big thing if you're a programmer, I'm sure.
Well, I would think so. And so I think that when you're embarking on a spiritual path, I think it's really important to be clear about one's intention. What are you looking for? And that's likely to change in the course of time. But wherever you are at this point, what are you looking for? And then find the teachers and the material which seem to offer or throw light on what you're looking for.
Yes.
And learn from them. And then one may work with a teacher for, you know, a number of years or whatever, and then work with another teacher because one's motivation has changed. Or you may work with the same teacher but in a different way because what you're interested in has changed as a result. Now, this was not always possible
right.
in earlier societies because there were huge restrictions from geography and culture and politics and things like that. Where, you're in a valley in Tibet, it was difficult to get to the next valley. I mean, it's major, it would be a four or five-day trek on yes. your own. And for long periods, you know, you had Zen and Pure Land in Japan, you had Chinese Buddhism, you had Tibetan Buddhism, you had Southeast Asian. They didn't speak to each other because the geographic gaps, distances were just so large. And it's only in the 20th century that they began actually to speak to each other. So
yes.
So that's a consideration. But when you do find a teacher, you still have the hard work of developing the actual capacities, and you can't just move to another teacher because you're going to have the same problem. You don't have the capacities. So sooner or later, you're going to have to learn how to play scales.
Okay. So just a question to build off of that. So, and this is something that it comes up a lot, both. When I start exploring this question with people, you know, what is it that's driving your practice, and what that you want, it brings up this really difficult question, which is how do you differentiate or distinguish between the motivation that you're describing, which is a lack of motivation or kind of a diminishment of motivation, perhaps not being connected with the right approach at that time. Maybe we've gotten something from it and we're sort of in with it for a while. Maybe we're just sort of ceding our authority to that, versus this lack of motivation that seems to be a natural part of most any path of learning, where there's highs and lows, and there's sometimes really big lows where you kind of have to just keep playing the scales for a while until something kind of clicks. You have to keep staring at the numbers until the sort of how you do calculus just sort of clicks. I remember having that experience with calculus. It was like, just like, ah! And I know you're a mathematician, so
yeah.
You probably yeah. had to deal with that a lot.
Yeah, but when it went click, what was it like?
Yeah, there was a sense of the whole world kind of changing and it not being really possible to see things the way I'd seen them before. Like now I kind of grokked how this thing worked.
Yeah, I mean, and can you imagine what it was like for Newton and Leibniz? Because they were the people who came up with these concepts and broke this totally new ground.
No, I can't imagine.
But I mean, it just opened up such a world that no one knew existed. Now we can talk about now we have a precise method for being able to calculate the volume of almost anything. Oh my God, what a difference, you know. And so, yeah, but that's exactly what it's like, is that you develop, and this is why I've been emphasizing the capacity thing. When you develop those capacities, it opens up whole new worlds, which I see many people trying to understand. But going back to your question, I think it's a really, yeah. really, I think it's a really difficult question. My response to it is, part of the illusion that we labor under in our society is that we actually have control over our life and our spiritual practice. And sometimes it's just happy accidents that take place. And there's the meeting the right person at the right time or something happening. And there's not necessarily rhyme or reason. One person is slogging away at, you know, something like that and experiences a breakthrough. Another person is slogging away at it and gives up and experiences a breakthrough. I mean, and there's stories of this. I mean, there's Saraha was one of the great Mahasiddhas. And he was doing Vajrayogini meditation for years, like 12 years. This complex visualization, praying to this very, very powerful Yadam, meditating on her. And after 12 years of this, he said, I'm not getting anywhere. And he threw his rosary down an Indian toilet. That's bad enough in our culture. You have no idea how overtop this is in Indian culture. And he just, he'd had it. Done. Finished.
Yep.
And that night, he went and he slept. And he had a really good night's sleep for a change because he wasn't busting his ass at practice. And when he was asleep, he had a dream. And in his dream, Vajrayogini appeared, holding his rosary and saying, you have to keep trying. And then gave, in the dream, gave him certain instructions. And mm-hmm. everything changed. Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
So we don't know when. So it's. I don't think there is any sure way of knowing. Sometimes we make the right decisions. Sometimes we make the wrong decisions. I encourage people to. In my own work, I've encouraged people to question and reappraise, so that they don't stay locked in something that seems counterproductive. And in all honesty, Vince, I don't know whether I'm giving them good advice or not. I'm just giving them advice that sometimes I wish I had been given at certain points in my career, or I'm giving them stuff that I found that has worked for me or has worked for certain kinds of people. And I think that's only what any teacher can do. And there is a huge amount of luck in this. Sometimes you just run into conditions and boom, stuff opens up and you and find the right teacher and you're filled with inspiration and you can just pour your energy into the work. And other times you get sick and it's just a slog and it's painful, and that's how it is. And so there isn't any right way for the path of practice to go. The path of practice is however it unfolds for you. And I would love to have had an easier one, but well, that was mine. But maybe it's a better thing for me not to have a particular path of practice, an easy path of practice, because I can sure sympathize with people who have trouble in their practice, too. So I don't know. I don't know if there's an answer to your question. Which is probably totally unsatisfactory from your point of view, but I'm sorry.
I'm used to that kind of thing from you, Ken, so at least I can sort of see it coming. okay, great. I think that's a good place to end. We're at the end of an hour, and thank you so much for getting on and chatting.
I'd just like to go back to the authority thing for a moment. I think it's a really important point. I think that what I want to do is distinguish here between faith and belief, because I think it's a really important distinction. Because you used both terms, belief and faith, when you were talking about that, and I find it helpful to distinguish them. When we have an idea inside ourselves, and we try to make the world conform or interpret the world in a way which reinforces that idea, that's what I call belief. And I find it restrictive and it closes us down. When we are, whether it's a idea that there's a God or that there's this awakening or whatever, and we use that idea as a way of opening to whatever life throws at us, that's what I regard as faith. Now, if you look at the way science progresses, science is utterly faith-based, which may sound like a very strange thing to say, but science says whatever the data, we have to relate to that. And if it throws out a mathematical or a theory that has been around for 500 years, so be it. So science actually proceeds on the basis of faith. Whatever the world throws us, open to that, and you start again with a new model or whatever.
Yes.
And good spiritual practice proceeds on the same basis. Okay, here am I experiencing this. This is what's going on. How do I relate to this? Not how do I make it fit into my beliefs? So I like to say belief makes bad spiritual practice and bad science, and faith makes good spiritual practice and good science. And there's a whole issue around authority on that, which I let everybody who's listening explore for themselves. So thank you.
Nice. All right. Cool. Well, yeah, thank you, everybody, for joining us. And then also thank you, Ken, for taking some time to talk about this stuff.
It's my pleasure. I very much enjoy our conversations. And so thank you for this opportunity. And whenever it happens, it's right to happen again. I'm up for it.
Great. I'm sure it'll be happening soon. if the past is any indication.
All right.
All right, great. Going offline.